Today, I want to tell you the story of a country. This is a country that stood firm against repeated Israeli attempts to steal their land. A country whose resilience against foreign Israeli aggression is a lesson to us all. A country who, sit down, Palestine, I'm not talking about you. This is a video about Akhzivland. And yes, I'm showing the uncensored flag. What are you going to do about it, YouTube? You already demonetized me. Now, let's start the history of the only country to defeat both Israel and the Palestinians. To understand the origins of the Great Republic of Akhzivland, you need to become familiar with its founder, the mad lad Eli Avivi. Avivi was born in Persia and moved to British-ruled Palestine. Growing up, Avivi was your stereotypical naughty kid. You know, cutting class, staying out late with his friends, putting bombs under trains carrying British troops, you know, stuff we've all done in our teenage years. Eventually, he got involved with underground Zionist militias and joined the Palyam, a group dedicated to illegally smuggling Jews into British Palestine. During the 1948 war, he fought against both the British and Arab forces. After the war, Avivi moved to Greenland, where he lived with the northern Inuit tribes for a few years. When Avivi eventually returned to Israel, he came to the beautiful beach at Akhziv, near the Lebanese border. Avivi fell in love with the location and built a house there for him and his wife Rina. But it turns out Avivi wasn't the only one who wanted that land, because it was only so long before he got a letter from the Israeli government. The letter stated that Israel wanted that land to build a military base and that they would be evicting Avivi. Avivi was furious, and he wrote a letter to Israeli Prime Minister Ben-Gurion asking for his house to be spared. In a Red Dead Redemption 1-style move, Ben-Gurion agreed to spare Avivi's house if, and only if, Avivi agreed to join the Shin Bet, aka the Israeli FBI. Avivi worked for the Shin Bet for a year, but when he finished and returned to his house, there was an Israeli soldier waiting for him there. Yeah, so you know how we said that if you worked for us, we wouldn't destroy your house? Well, yeah, we were like totally lying when we said that, and we're building that military base anyway. The bulldozers are going to be coming in tomorrow. Dude, uncool. Avivi decided that he had had enough of these oppressive Israeli policies. He said that he'd make his own country. Avivi and Rina seceded from Israel, declaring the establishment of the independent country of Akhzivland, and triumphantly ripped up their Israeli passports. They were, of course, immediately arrested by Israel and thrown in jail. In court, Avivi was charged with illegally creating a country without permission. But Avivi made the genius argument that there was no Israeli law that prevented you from creating your own country. The lawyers checked all the books, and sure enough, they could not find a single law that prevented you from starting your own country. But Avivi took it one step further and actually got the Israeli government to lease him the land in Akhziv for 99 years. Avivi and Rina were fined a single cent for the crime of destroying their passports, and they were released to establish a new state. You heard that correctly. Avivi really pulled a, there's no rules dogs can't play basketball, on the Israeli judge. Why don't the Palestinians just do this? Are they stupid? Avivi became the president of Akhzivland after he was democratically elected by his own vote. His wife couldn't vote, of course. Women didn't have the right in Akhzivland. But to be fair, can you imagine a country where there were only two votes, one for a boomer and one for his wife? Nothing would ever get done. Anyway, Akhzivland was a shining example of democracy in the Middle East. Or at least that's what Avivi wants us to think. I was able to find this picture of Avivi wearing a crown, which makes me think that actually... Ow, ow, what the hell, Avivi, how do you get to my house? I'm sorry, I won't tell them. Anyway, like I was saying, Akhzivland was a pretty perfect democracy. Life in Akhzivland attracted many visitors who want to live away from the law for one reason or another. People in Akhzivland would walk around without any clothing and do drugs that were illegal in Israel. Since in Israel, all marriage must be done by a religious authority, people would come to Akhzivland to get a secular marriage, which would then be recognized when they went back to Israel. Akhzivland became a sort of anarchist hippie paradise and attracted some celebrities like legendary actor Paul Newman, Israeli model Bar Rafaeli, and the future Israeli Prime Minister Shimon Peres. At Akhzivland, Avivi took up a hobby of naked photography and amassed a collection of... Wait, that can't be right. Oh, never mind, it really is. Avivi amassed a collection of 1 million photos of naked women that he himself took. 1 million! That's not even getting into all the R-rated stuff that went down at Akhzivland. Eli Avivi had an insane sex life that began with him losing his virginity at the age of 10 to his 23-year-old cousin. And the story just gets more insane from there, but I can't really touch on it due to YouTube being YouTube. I linked a Hebrew article in the description that you will regret reading if you want to learn more. Moving on. Now, Akhzivland probably seems pretty peaceful, but remember, this is the Middle East, and peace is illegal here. So, this is where the Palestinians finally come into the story. So, let me introduce you to a little group called the PLO. It started in 1959 when a Palestinian man named Yasser Arafat met a man named Abu Jihad, whose name kind of sounds like if you asked an American conservative from the middle of rural South Dakota to come up with a Muslim name. Together, they founded the Palestine Liberation Organization, or Harkat al-Tahrir al-Falastini, or for short, Hataf. But Arafat and Abu Jihad quickly realized that Hataf meant untimely death in Arabic, and probably wasn't the best acronym for their group. So they reversed it, and the new acronym became Fatah, which meant victory. That certainly sounded cooler, but it was technically no longer an acronym. Anyway, Fatah, or the PLO as they would come to be known, became the biggest Palestinian armed group. You still hear about them in the news sometimes, usually mispronounced as Fatah. Anyway, when the PLO heard that Akhzivland broke off, what do you think their reaction was? Was it A, wow, Akhzivland's story of struggle for independence from Israel is strikingly similar to our own fight for freedom. We should congratulate them on their success, and perhaps one day they can be our ally. Or B, wait, you're telling me there are a bunch of Jews who live by themselves on a beach, and the Israeli army doesn't protect them? Oh my god, let's go kill them! If you answered B, you are correct. Due to Akhzivland's lack of any IDF presence, the PLO sent a group of six commando gunmen on a mission to kill Eli and Rina. The six infiltrated Israel at night on a boat from Lebanon and stealthily made their way to Akhzivland. But when they opened the door, Rina Avivi was waiting for them, pointing a gun at them. Five of them dropped their weapons and bolted, but one of them was captured by Rina. After incapacitating the gunmen, she contacted the Israeli military and told them what happened. The IDF quickly arrived and arrested the remaining commandos as they attempted to flee back to Lebanon. Seeing all the Israeli military vehicles heading towards Akhziv, many locals assumed that the time had come and Israel had finally decided to take Akhzivland back by force. So, the Battle of Akhzivland ended in humiliation. Zero Israeli casualties and six PLO commandos captured. An unusually successful operation by Palestinian standards. But that victory shouldn't be taken for granted. To understand why, let's take a look at the story of another, much more violent beach micronation that rebelled against Israel. The Independent Jewish Authority on Gaza Beach, or the IJAGB. To understand the IJAGB, you first need to understand the circumstances that led to its creation. Believe it or not, there actually used to be thousands of Jews who lived in the Gaza Strip in addition to Palestinian Arabs. But in 2005, Israel decided to pull all Jews out of Gaza and give Gaza completely to the Palestinians, assuming that that would lead to peace. It's safe to say that many of the Israeli Jews living in Gaza settlements didn't love that idea. In particular, one Israeli historian named Aryeh Yitzchaki living in the Gazan town of Shirat Hayam had had enough. When Israeli forces announced that they would forcefully evict the members of his town, he decided to instead lead a rebellion against Israel. Under Yitzchaki's leadership, Shirat Hayam and the neighboring town of Kfar Yam seceded from Israel, declaring themselves the Independent Jewish Authority on Gaza Beach, and submitted a request to join the UN. He declared himself temporary chairman until the 2,000 citizens of the IJAGB would hold elections. Israel didn't really like that, so the IDF besieged the two towns. But Yitzchaki didn't plan on going down without a fight, so he had the citizens of the IJAGB booby-trap their houses and go on top of their roofs to create sniper nests. He announced that he would open fire on any Israeli soldier who tried to evacuate them. But Israel put down the rebellion pretty quickly without any deaths on either side, and the two towns were evacuated. Bro really thought he was Eli Avivi. Maybe if he would have gotten rid of the old yee-ass haircut he got, he would have gotten some international recognition. But at least the Gaza pullout ended the conflict there and everyone lived happily ever after. Right? Right? Anyway, I got a bit distracted there. Back to Avivi. Akhzivland lived on, and although Israel did try to win back the land in court multiple times, they were never successful. And of course, women never got voting rights, despite Rina literally saving Akhzivland. Sadly, Eli Avivi passed away in 2018, but the words he uttered before he died drove thousands to the beaches. My nude photos? If you want them, you can have them. I buried them all in one piece. Okay, but in all seriousness, I have no idea what happened to his 1 million naked photos. Anyway, are you interested in learning about the SS Nazi commander who infiltrated the Israeli army? Are you interested in learning about the story of the terrorist rabbi who may have killed Tupac? Do you want to learn about the rogue Israeli general who tried to assassinate the defense minister? Do you want to go further than what you hear on the news and actually explore the deep lore of Israel and Palestine? Because on this channel, I plan to go all the way down the Israel and Palestine iceberg. I have some insane videos planned that'll make my video on the Jewish Nazi Dalai Lama look like surface-level normie facts. But I need your help, because YouTube completely demonetized my channel, and at the end of the day, I'm just one guy making these vids as a side hobby. So, I started a Patreon where you can fund me if you want. The Patreon will help me make higher quality videos and more consistently. So, if you're interested in deep Levantine lore, come on over and join the Merchants Guild. Anyway, I hope you all enjoyed that video. By the way, I also made an email account that I put in the channel bio. Please direct all sponsorship requests, questions, video suggestions, death threats, and marriage requests to there. And as always, don't forget to defenestrate the like and subscribe buttons. Long live the Guama, and I'll see you next time.